in the first two parts of this response to Guillaume's video, Pseudonautics, Episode 3, Soft Landing, we lost count of the number of math errors we found in Guillaume's calculations. We discovered that Guillaume blindly used numbers from a rocket simulator without really understanding what he had in his hands, and then we looked at the dynamic pressure and corrected Guillaume's equivalent Earth wind speed, which he thought was important. Then we asked, what's the worst thing that could happen? This is what could happen. 17.7 megawatts. Whoa, Nelly! That's big! That's huge! That's... what is it exactly? Well, Guillaume took one half of his flow rate times his effective exhaust velocity squared to get the kinetic energy in each second of exhaust. The first time you were probably exposed to this equation was in the sixth grade, and the example probably had something to do with a car running into a tree. Here, for example, a 3,200-pound automobile traveling at 32 miles per hour has a kinetic energy of 98,800 foot-pounds. Upon crashing into a tree that doesn't move, the tree has to expend 98,800 foot-pounds of energy in order to stop the car. Another example is one that Guillaume uses, an astronaut weighing 200 newtons on the moon. Ha! Subtract the mass of his suit and his pliss, and there's not even a 98-pound weakling left. While this astronaut is walking on the moon, at the apex of his step he has 20 joules of potential energy. After falling 10 centimeters in 150 milliseconds, my stopwatch gave 600 milliseconds, he has 133 watts of kinetic energy, which is actually wrong on so many levels, but then he takes that and divides it by 0.06 meters squared, the total area of the astronaut's feet. The astronauts wore overboots on their EVAs. If they wore size 7.5 overboots, then their PGA boots couldn't be any larger than a size 5.5. Pygmy astronauts on the moon? Again, we shouldn't be surprised. He made the astronauts look too small so he could make some comparison and make the limb look even more powerful than it really was. Anyway, this is the only way I can figure you can get a number close to as 2170 watts per meter squared. This is actually a bad example, but what he's showing is that the moon had to push back with 133 watts of energy to stop the pygmy astronaut's fall. In both cases, the moving object stops. So, dividing 17.7 megawatts by 1.75 meters squared gives you 10 megawatts per square meter. For whatever that matters. So how much damage are all those megawatts going to cause on the lunar surface? Well, look at this picture. Where are all the kilograms of energy-depleted nitrogen tetroxide? If a tree can stop a car, and the lunar surface can stop a pygmy astronaut from falling, then it must be true that the lunar surface can stop the propellants being thrown at it, right? There should be dozens of kilograms of propellants lying on the lunar surface directly under the nozzle. Where are they? Is this me being condescending again? No, not really. Obviously, the gases did not lose all their energy when they hit the lunar surface. For the most part, they bounced off and went in different directions, carrying some of the lunar surface with them. We'll look at that in more detail later. I'm going to blow through this Phoenix lander comparison. Like the X-Core example, this shows that a very small thruster focused on a very small area can push less than an inch of dust around. Duh. Most of the rest of his video is the same type stuff. Useless analysis of hover jets and hand waving. But I don't want to pass up the most fascinating part of Guillaume's video. That is this journal article from a Dr. Gromov that shows that the top 4 to 5 inches of the lunar surface could be disturbed by the dynamic pressure from the lunar module's exhaust. Why this fascinates me is the fact that Guillaume is using data from recorded measurements of lunar core samples brought back by the Apollo astronauts to build a case that the astronauts didn't go to the moon to collect those core samples. And so it goes. If Guillaume doesn't believe these core samples came from the moon, then how can he use the data from them to discredit the landings? this is like standing naked in a room full of people and thinking that by closing your eyes, nobody can see you. It's ridiculous. I guess that's the privilege of being a conspiracist. You can use anybody's data you want to, even if it comes from the source you're trying to discredit. So, how bad a job did Guillaume really do? What do the correct numbers look like? Well, assuming worst case on the later J-series missions, the lunar modules landed with a little more than 13 kilonewtons on board. The main disturbance area, half a foot under the nozzle, was 2.14 meters squared. The static pressure model says that the absolute pressure in this area was 1.4 kilopascals. The equivalent velocity of the descent engine was 486 meters per second. To remain at hover, the propellant mass required to push through the nozzle was 27.4 kilograms. The kinetic energy in these gases was about 6.5 megawatts. Now, if you consider that about 3 inches of regolith is missing out by the landing pads, then probably 4 to 6 inches is missing from directly under the nozzle, although we can't prove that easily from the photos. The span of the landing pads was 31 feet, tip to tip. Subtract 3 feet for each pad, and we can estimate the disturbance area just inside the pads was about 494 square feet. Assuming the missing regolith was 3 inches deep throughout the entire area, that's 3,474,000 cubic centimeters. Lunar regolith at the surface is usually quoted to have a density of 2.3 to 2.6 grams per cubic centimeter. Taking the conservative end and multiplying by the volume, we get 7,990 kilograms of missing regolith. Wow, that's a bunch. That's almost 9 earth tons of missing material. If you assume an elastic collision of the gas into the regolith, then the gas molecules bounce off, losing only 7 parts per million of their original momentum, while the entire mass of regolith assumes a velocity increase of 3 millimeters per second. That's average per bombardment. It also tells us that it would take the equivalent of 300 seconds of bombardment to give the entire mass a velocity of 1 meter per second. Since the gas loses almost none of its momentum, it'll bounce around and continue to collide with everything it can. And the regolith directly under the nozzle, of course, will pick up most momentum and move the farthest. The effect would feather off as you get out to the pads and probably continue out well beyond the immediate landing site to some extent. That's it. It's more a strip mine than a crater. In conclusion, I must say that I am impressed that a moon hoaxer would attempt any mathematical analysis to prove a point. I want to encourage Dr. Guillaume to try again. And again. But next time, show your work. Dr. Guillaume. Doctor of what, I wonder? Obviously, it's nothing to do with math or science. Otherwise, God save the French. Try as he could, Guillaume failed to make a convincing case for his craters. Pointing to old conceptual drawings, an X-Corps methane rocket, the Phoenix lander, hover jets, all that was irrelevant. Over 90% of the video had nothing to do with the lunar module. His major evidence of sizzling propellant velocities and megawatt energy pulses got deflated considerably when we redid his math. His math, flawed as it was, did nothing more than suggest that the hot gases expelled from the lunar module descent engine were moving relatively fast, but have very little density. So what? No matter how fast the gases are moving, the total pressure on the surface, dynamic plus static, caused by the lunar module at hover, cannot exceed the weight, that's the mass times gravitational attraction, of the lunar module itself, or it wouldn't be able to land. Why? Why is that so hard for you moon hoaxers to understand? I'm done. Another conspiracist video debunked. 1,000 more to go. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.